Hello everyone, and welcome to the 18th episode of Point of View, a series of leadership discussions by Amazing Workplaces. In this series, I'm getting into a discussion with people in leadership positions from various organizations spread across India as well as across borders. The idea is to get into conversation with them, to get them to share their views about the various aspects that make organizations really amazing. The purpose is to understand what drives leaders to their own workplaces so that we can delve deeper into the corporate philosophy and share with you path-breaking ideas, ideas that come straight from people who have gone ahead and changed their workplace to make them better, more inviting, and extremely thriving for their own people. Our guest on the show today has transformed culture of Fortune 500 organizations by fostering an inclusive and diverse work environment, enabling employees to bring their authentic selves and do the best work of their lives. In his last role as head of inclusion and diversity, he led the integration of D&I into HR and business to create exponential value for Cisco in India and Asia Pacific region. For him, inclusion, diversity, and belonging efforts goes beyond the workplace. He's none other than Srini Ramaswamy, co-founder Pride Circle. Pride Circle is India's premier diversity and inclusion organization with a mission to enable and empower LGBT plus people and support organizations in fostering a culture of belonging for all. Pride Circle is leading the LGBT plus inclusion revolution in India. Amongst his many achievements, Srini is a senior advisor at TEDx India, Connecting Dreams Foundation, Solidarity Foundation Women's Education Project USA, and he spreads his ideas on social welfare, equality and inclusion, human rights, women education and empowerment, sustainability, and smart village development projects. He is a certified diversity professional and has been recognized with various global accolades, awards and speaking opportunities. Welcome, Srini. It's a pleasure to have you on Point of View today.
Thank you, Ekta. Thanks for having me and thanks for the wonderful introduction. I'm so glad that we finally managed to make time for the conversation that is really close to my heart.
Thank you, Srini. We have been trying to connect with each other for such a long time, and I'm so glad that at least, for Point of View, I could get your time and have this conversation today. Thank you so much. So, Srini, you're extremely passionate about the issues related to diversity and inclusion, especially with regard to the LGBT plus community and the acceptance in the corporate world. The issue is so close to your heart that in 2018, you quit your flourishing career and donned the hat of a full-time social entrepreneur, co-founding Pride Circle, which is India's premier diversity and inclusion organization, with a mission to enable and empower LGBT plus people and support organizations in fostering a culture of belonging for all. So what motivated you or led you to become a crusader of something that occupies such a sensitive space in our society?
Thanks for asking the question, Ekta. I think it's a very pertinent question and very close to my heart, like you rightly mentioned. Inclusion, diversity, and belonging is something that has been there not yesterday, but the time that I was born. There have been a lot of life events and incidents, lived experiences that I've personally gone through. At school and at college, which really forced me to step back and think as to why in our country we treat each other different. Whether you are from a north versus south or east versus west, or you are from a different culture, or you have a different customs, these are something which are very prevalent in our country. I'm talking about the time when I was growing up. There was very little conversation about diversity and inclusion back. I'm talking about mid 80s. And that was a time when I was in my schooling, and you know, the experiences of a family from southern India, which is in Bangalore, living up in north, because my parents had jobs, you know, and having to live through those experiences of how, you know, one would get treated for being different. I think, you know, that was a starting point about the experiences of bullying, name calling, experiences of having to being referred as a madrasi and a you know, somebody who would be referred as a dosa in Italy. Having to go through that experiences and really introspect as to why we have to go through that experience, right? And live the entire life with that scar. And that is something that kind of really, really pinched me and really, really disturbed me deep down. I think, you know, that has been my journey, you know, from then on, you know, to do my graduation and master's in business administration in HR, choosing to get into the function of HR, working with people, challenging the mindsets, stereotypes, and ensuring that, you know, we truly believe in working on bringing the diverse minds and thoughts. I think that has been my journey, and that is where the passion comes from. My own lived experiences, my own experiences of going through at that young age.
Right.
So I think that is precisely, you know, what is very close to my heart, because it's impacted my heart.
So Srini, if I understand, whatever experiences that you had during your childhood days, they impacted you in such a deep manner that you took a conscious decision to choose a career path that you actually did. Yeah.
Yes, it did. It did. You know, I'll talk about a bit about my family. You know, what I've seen at home. Right. Both my parents were working professionals. So because of my the home, the design of the home, it was such a way that I saw both my parents sharing equal opportunity, right? So I would see my mother and my father share the you know, household work and chores and, you know, work together. And there was greater degree of respect for one another. There was so much of, you know, trust, and there was so much of, you know, not taking for granted. You know, when you get into the school and when you start experiencing, that is when you realize that, you know, the world that you have at home and the world that you have outside are two different experiences. What you get, you know, support at home would be very different from outside. And like I mentioned to you about my lived experiences about, you know, being from a South Indian family, speaking a different language, looking different. I think that was the most difficult part of my life. I'm talking about the standard 5th and standard 6th. And it continued till about, you know, 9th and the 10th standard, till the time, you know, I had the ability to perhaps, you know, counter those questions and respond to the questions in a better manner.
Right.
And I think that point of time, I knew that I need to understand the human psyche and the makeup of humans slightly more. Wherein I can contribute to this in the future. What I wanted to do, how I wanted to do, I had no idea. Back then, there were no programs or courses or curriculums that we had the way we have today. You know, the MBA colleges and other organizations, institutions are offering programs. So when I chose to go for master's in business administration with the human resources as specialization.
Yeah.
Now, I'm talking about, you know, late 90s and early 2000s. And again, you know, I would hear these comments saying that, you know, HR is a function for women.
Yeah.
It is not for men.
True.
And why would you want to get into function? Because there, you know, it would be very difficult for you to have a voice, because, you know, that's a desk job. It is an easy job. You know, it does not require you to, you know. And then people would immediately relate, saying that, okay, because you're not good at education and you didn't score high grades, perhaps that's the best, you know, program or a course for you. So every walk of life, my decision or my choices were challenged. Right. So imagine, you know, a child going through that experience at school, gets discriminated, gets name called, goes into a cocoon of becoming an introvert, and then choosing to make a conscious decision of doing something, because there would be many more like me.
Okay, thank you, Srini, for answering this. So, what I understand is that there was a lot of unconscious bias that you had to go through while growing up. And unconscious bias is a problem that a majority of us are not even aware of. Yeah, your own childhood experiences, like you just related, they were actually about unconscious bias, and it led to you taking, certain lasting decisions in your life. So I want to understand, from an organizational perspective, what is the importance of handling unconscious bias, and how can organizations address this situation in the most effective manner?
Yeah, Ekta, you're right. You know, there has always been an unconscious bias that all of us carry. And I always talk about it in terms of the nature versus nurture. And we always go through those experiences as we are growing up. Nobody tells us to treat the other person differently. And before you realize, over the 30 years, you've already added so much so that it starts playing out on an everyday basis without even you recognizing and acknowledging that you are speaking something which is perhaps not the best way to express yourself. And all of this comes at workplace, because that's where you would end up spending most of your time. Right? So the world before COVID was different, because we would have had the interaction with the co-workers in person. And you had the opportunity to, talk to the person one-on-one at the workplace and trying to arrest that. Now with the post-COVID scenario, and we're still going through COVID, the unconscious bias or the workplace has become virtual. So there's all the more reason for us to work on these unconscious bias. The companies have to work on investing their efforts consciously on arresting the unconscious bias. How it plays out in our decision-making process, whether we have to hire somebody, whether we have to promote somebody, whether we have to, assign quality work, whether we have to get people back to workforce, like returning mothers, or the some of the unconscious biases that we have across the age group, multi-generation, or with a person with disability, or even for that matter, the LGBT plus community. So there are these unconscious biases that we carry. And there are biases both sides, and most of the organizations are doing that, by having a set of training programs or talking about these biases that we all have. So I think it all starts with acknowledging that all of us have unconscious bias. We can neutralize it by becoming conscious about it.
So thank you, Srini. Thank you for answering this so well for us. So tell me one thing, Srini, what is the status of diversity and inclusion in Indian workplaces? You work a lot in this space, so I'm sure you're the right person to actually, answer this question. And going forward, how can we make improvements, and how can more and more organizations ensure the representation of minorities in the workforce?
I think, I'm still learning, Ekta. I'm no expert yet in this space, and I continue to learn from some of my industry leaders and colleagues in India and outside. I see that there is a lot of shift has happened in the last 5 to 8 years in the country, especially talking about the inclusion and diversity. Can we do more? Yes. How can we do more by including the minority groups is to collectively work on the diversity and inclusion. It is not sequential. I mean, there has always been an approach which is more sequential, which means that, okay, let's look at working on women diversity first. Let's look at, you know, addressing the women leadership pipeline. Then we will talk about a multi-generation, and then we'll talk about a PWD, then we'll talk about LGBT. So, you know, you're the conversation about the minority excluded communities take a far lesser conscious affirmative action. You have to collectively work on it. Because when you collectively work on all the strands or all the themes of different communities and diverse talent, that growth or that impact will be exponential.
Right.
And that truly represents in how the teams operate.
Right.
You know, there are enough and more research, enough and more studies which talks about how having a diverse workforce really impacts. But a lot of other behavioral scientists have mentioned that it is not just about diversity and inclusion, but it is all about belonging.
Yeah.
The moment I feel that this is a place where I truly belong, this is a place where I can truly be my authentic self. This is the place where I won't be questioned about the way I look, the way I come to work, or the way I speak, or the way I present my ideas, the way my working styles are, right? The moment I don't have to pretend or wear a mask at work, whether in person or virtual world, I think that is where the belonging is, and that is where I will give my 100%. So that is where we have to focus on. And companies today are, you know, very, very consciously realizing that if I have to make you and me feel we belong, we need to really focus on things like, you know, unconscious bias, stereotypes, the debunking some of the myths.
Thank you, Srini, for answering this one. So let me come to your own organization now. So, you know, when it comes to your own organization, with your experience in diversity, with the kind of belief that you have, what are the various aspects of diversity that you keep in mind while creating your own team? And according to you, what are the positive impacts of having a diverse team?
A great question. I think, you know, I would answer this. Let's say if a doctor prescribes a medicine to the patients and the doctor doesn't believe in his own medicine, what the doctor is prescribing, then the doctor is not doing justice to the oath that they have taken. Very much similar to that, if I don't believe in walking the talk, if I don't believe in mimicking my thoughts in my own organization, and I won't be doing justice. So a lot of my thoughts around, you know, the need to create a culture which is respectful, which is building communities, building trust, building collaboration, celebrating each other's differences, valuing each other's thoughts and ideas, views. I think unless and until I promote this consciously, affirmatively, I won't be doing justice in my organization. And hence, you know, my decision of having worked in the corporate for close to 20 years and choosing to become a social entrepreneur happened in 2018. I always was, you know, very keen to, you know, do something more than within the four walls of the organization and do more to the shifting in the societal mindset. And that is how, you know, I had the opportunity to work with some of the great leaders, you know, having to go through the, experimenting with different ideas, even before I took the plunge of social entrepreneur. And I knew that the organization that I want to build and the things that I want to implement and the aspects I don't want to bring, right? And today, you know, because I work in the space of LGBT plus inclusion, because we work with different stakeholders, whether we talk about at home, whether with parents and children or teenagers, whether at school or colleges with the teachers and the administration and the students, or whether at workplaces between the leaders, managers, HR, and the employees. I think all of this becomes only possible when I truly walk the talk, which means that if I have my workforce from the community. And I'm really glad to share that over these, 4 years of our journey of Right Circle, we've managed to build a team which is majority of them are from the community.
Okay.
And it is the other way around. So there are very strong supporters and allies like myself who are really rallying behind the community and raising our voice and showing our visible commitment to the whole efforts. That really sort of adds on and creates. So if you're talking about our representation in the organization on from a lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, asexual, trans man to trans woman, we have all the voices within the organization. It helps us to make sure that we are truly inclusive. We only work remote. We don't have a physical office space. Another very conscious decision we took 4 years back. Our teams, staff works across India, yeah, from tier two, tier three. There are staff who come from different backgrounds of their own lived experiences, the language that they speak, the identities and sexuality they come from, the education background, somebody who's not even completed the 10th, or a returning mother who wanted who took break for 9 years after maternity, is also part of our team. So, we truly believe in walking the talk. We truly believe in, consciously look for opportunities that we can extend to the communities, anyone who is well deserving.
Yeah.
And sometimes we have to do a positive discrimination. And to going back to the point of, if I don't believe in my own medicine, then I cannot prescribe it to others. So I have to walk the talk. I have to demonstrate that I truly believe in. And we get a lot of times this question that, you working for the community so much more. Do you have your own staff? What is the makeup of your staff? What is the representation? And we consciously look at identifying talented people. Education has never been our focus. It's always been skill.
Right.
We have found people who are very skilled, who are just the 9th standard pass out. And we have them on our team. We end up creating a workplace which is safe and respectful. I think that is what we have created today. The attrition is zero. A lot of them have quit their full-time corporate jobs to join us. And it truly talks about the impact, because now we are able to find individuals who can truly help the organizations grow in their journey of the LGBT inclusion, which means that somebody, some company wants to focus on the trans inclusion at workplace. We have people who can truly work with them and help them understand at what it means to create a safe space for transgender persons.
Right.
I think that is what the impact is. Once we have the right voices within our organization, they not only demonstrate the level of trust within the organization, but also goes out and, starts impacting the other ecosystem.
Right. Thank you, Srini. I think you're truly walking the talk. You're on a very passionate journey, and I'm sure that your team must be really proud to be working with you. Thank you, Srini, for coming on Point of View and sharing your ideas on diversity and inclusion. It was really a very insightful conversation that I had with you today. Thank you so much once again.
Thanks, Ekta. I really enjoyed this conversation. Thanks again for having me.
Thank you.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel today to receive updates about latest videos on topics related to leadership, employee engagement, culture, workplaces, and human resources.